What is a report basically? You have done a project in your school, you do the project, or you write the report. So are the project and the report the same thing? Can any one of you answer that question? Can the project be the report be your project? Yes, Tamali, can the project be your report? You have no idea. Farina? No answers. What is the matter with you today? Usually you cannot, you answer now. Can you hear me? All of you can hear me, right? Oh, you can't hear. Who can answer the questions? Bahagya? Let me ask someone else. Yes, Anuttara, tell me, can your project be your report?
Yes, madam.
Yes, is the project and your report? If I ask you to do a project, if you bring me a report, is that all right? Or are they two different things?
I think has different.
Yes, correct. So they are different, right? You do the project and you present the report of that project. So if you, for example, if you do a project for your, imagine it's a school student for your A-levels, you do the project and the report of that project, right? In Sinhala, we call this the Vartava, right? So in order to write a report, you should have done something. You do it and then you write a report on that, right? So without having a project, you cannot actually write a report or project or anything, right? You without doing a test, you cannot write a report, right? Without having an exam, you cannot write a student report like that, okay? Yes. What is a report? You write a report, it is the, you need to understand that the report is written for a specific audience, right? And it differs from different disciplines. According to the discipline, the report, the structure of a report and the function of a report changes. So you cannot have the same structure in a lab report or a student's report or what you call a financial report, right? These all these types of reports are different. So it is written for an audience, for a specific audience. What are the different types of reports that you know? Financial reports, lab reports, I have mentioned. Can any one of you add another type of report? Feasibility reports, right? Whether it is possible to do this kind of thing. Project reports and research reports, right? So we can, if you can see, case study reports, right? You do a case study. Industrial training reports, if you go on a training or if you go on an internship, your report on that, right? So there are different types of reports. What should be included in a report? Yes, actually this should be a discussion. Can you all unmute your microphones and answer these questions? What should be included in a report? Yes, Tamali? Can anyone tell, can you all unmute the microphone and tell me what should be included in a report? Who can answer that? Yes, what should be included in a report? Can you all send me a message in the chat box as to what you think should be included in a report? Using the chat box, maybe you can send. Right. What should be included in the report? What are the contents? For example, the title page, right? Then you have a table of contents. like that. Then there is the summary or the abstract. I think you know already, right? You have written reports at different times of your life. Yes, what are the components in the report?
Conclusion.
Correct. Good. The conclusion is there.
Body of the report.
Body of the report. Yes, anyone else?
References.
References, good. Yes, anything else, Sanjay? References, conclusion, body, title, contents. With conclusions, we could have something called what? Along with the conclusion? The recommendations would be also there, right? Conclusion and recommendations, right? So those are the things. Contents, yes, introduction should be there, right? So the table of contents, introduction, body, right? Those are the things, right? We'll see, we'll have a look at that. What should be included in a report? What you include in your report and how you present it will vary according to your discipline and the specific purpose of the report. Right? So, but basically, as you mentioned, these things are there. The structure of the report is the same. There will be the title, and if you have added an acknowledgements, right, that should be there. And then there will be a table of contents, and then there will be a summary, but not all of them. Most of the reports have a summary, right? But not all of them. So a summary and the body of the introduction, body paragraphs, right? Chapters in the middle or sections, and then conclusions and recommendations. After that, we have the appendices and references, right? So that is, those are the basic components of a research. And do all different types of reports have the same format? No, right? So they do not have the same format, but the same, there is some similarity, right? There is some structural similarity in every report, right? So the components of each report is basically the same, although there might be some minor changes here and there, right? So we'll look at the answers in detail then. Why do we need to learn how to write a report? Why is it necessary to write a report? Why do we have to learn this skill? Because the way we write a report is different than our everyday language, the language that we use day to day. So you see, the way I'm speaking in a lecture and the way I speak in a normal conversation is different, right? So in the language that is used in a report is different. You need to learn a scientific language, and you are writing for an academic audience, those who know about the subject, right? So for example, if you are writing a project report for your exam, you will be writing it to your department head or your supervisor, so that they know about the sub language. Has to be technical, and it's a specific skill that you have to write. Everyone who knows the language cannot write reports. Right, so you have to learn this skill. It's a different skill, just as summarizing and letter writing. It is a skill that has to be practiced, right? Right. So they here are the answers for your questions that we have already discussed. You can read the questions and the answers and see. All the questions are there. Why do we need to learn how to write a report? Because report writing is an essential skill for academic and professional writing. It is a skill that has to be learned, right? For academic and professional writing, you need this skill. And look at the definition they have given for what is a report. A report is written for a clear purpose and to a particular audience. Right? So the basic definition that they give for the report is purpose and the audience. So according to the purpose and the definition of the report, for the feasibility report and a lab report might be very much different. Can you read silently the questions and the answers? Okay, right. So I hope you have understood what is it. Right? There are some other types of reports also. System analysis reports, client case work reports, case study reports. You know what are case studies? The case study, that means now just as much as you do a research involving a lot of participants, you have a case study, means the case study of a single person, right? Feasibility studies, that means whether something can be achieved or not. Business reports, analysis reports, financial analysis reports, all those come up in some way a report. Do all the different types of reports have the same format? No, what is the accepted report conventions are in your study, in your department, in your field of study, right? These conventions may vary from one subject to the next, right? So, but for a technological subject, your report might be having the same structure, right? So, okay, now we are going into detail. What is the basic structure of a report? So, as you said earlier, we looked at the summary, table of contents, introduction, and the middle sections, or as Jamali said, the body of the report. So, they need to be numbered, right? Now, in your school project report, perhaps you did not number your headings, but the chapter headings need to be numbered as 1.2, 1.3 and so on, right? We'll look at it. And then conclusions and recommendations and references and appendices, right? So appendices come at the end. Now, there is no possibility of changing this. Is there a internet connection problem? Can you all hear clearly?
No, madam.
Why is that? Even I had some problem with the internet. Is it the same for everyone? Like you hear only parts of it. Can the others speak up and Nilukshi, this one. Who was it? Anuttara, can you hear me clearly?
Yes, madam.
Yes, pardon, it seems it's only for you. Why are there a few students for today's lecture? Usually there are more than that, isn't it? Is it because it's an extra lecture, but then they have to inform. No, I think this one is not there. Who is it? Yeah, sure, this is not there. Most of the students are not there. They need to come. Otherwise, but the problem is when you write a faulty report, your heads and the other staff might think that we have not taught you properly the lesson. Right. So we look at the structure of the report. The report usually has the following components: title, summary, table of contents, introduction, middle section, conclusion, references, and appendices. Right. So as I was telling you, the basic structure has to be this. You can't change this structure. Right. For example, you can't take the table of contents before the summary. After the title page, you need to have the summary. Another word for the summary is abstract, right? So after the table of contents, if you have the acknowledgments, will come here. The acknowledgments come here. Then the table of contents, introduction, like that, right? So you will see why we can't change this structure. I mean, if you try your academic reports, this structure cannot change, right? Right, then you see what the title page is about. The title page usually provides the title of the report, the author's name and the student's numbers, the course name and number, semester, department, university, date of submission, and if it is an assignment, the assignment number, right? So, I don't have a sample topic title page here, but if in the title page you need to have clearly the title and all these other details, right? The student's names, all the names, student numbers, and the department and for whom you are submitting this report. It's very essential. So right, you need to say that it is an assignment for this department, for the Department of Industrial Management, assignment number, right? So without having a reference, you must not have a project report, right? It must have a reference. To whom are you submitting this report? Is it a part of an assignment? Or has it been requested by an organization? Has it been requested by your manager? So that information has to be there in the title page. Right. We look at a few sample titles here. Following are the titles provided by two students for a report. What title will score more marks by? Right. So three or four students' titles. What is the best title? Bridge analysis, analysis of pre-stressed concrete bridge. What would be the better title here? Who can answer that? You see. Yes, Sanjay, can you say what is the better title for this? Is it bridge analysis or analysis of pre-stressed concrete bridges? Who can say answer this first one? Chaturanga, which is the better title? Sorry?
Third one?
Third one, there are no third one. There are only two titles, bridge analysis or analysis of pre-stressed concrete bridge. out of the two, which is the better one?
Analysis of present
concrete bridge. Yes, that is the correct one, right? Pre-stressed concrete bridge. Yeah, that is the better one. Why do you think that is better? It gives more information, isn't it? Yes, internet-based ATIS and evaluation. Can you all switch off the unmute the microphones and answer the questions for the activities at least? I don't mind the background noise. You can ask all the people in the house to be quiet, right? And you can take part in the activities. Otherwise, it will take a lot of time. Even if they're shouting, it doesn't matter, right? Otherwise, we are taking a lot of time to answer the question. Internet-based ATIS. Next one is an evaluation of internet-based automation travel information systems. Yes, Ratnayaka.
B, an evaluation of internet-based automation traveler information systems.
Correct. Who is that? What is your name, B?
Chaturika.
Chaturika. Good. Thank you. Yes, that is the best ever. Then next one, assignment. Assignment 1, water consumption data collection. Yes, Chaturanga, quickly.
Assignment 1, consumption data collection.
Yes, correct. ATIS project. Or ATIS project, an investigation of ATIS on the Southern Highway. Yes, Kasuni, which is the better answer? A or B? Correct. B is the answer, right? I say OU, it's Southern Highway, right? So why are these answers the better ones? They give more information and the title is narrowed down. So if you give an answer, once you write a report and submit it to the supervisor will ask you to narrow down your topic. For example, if it is internet-based ATIS, it is too broad, no? Internet-based ATIS, it's a broad topic. You can't handle it within a report. So you are just going to do an evaluation of it. Is it good or bad? Or what are the positive or negative aspects of it? So that only the evaluation. Otherwise, you might have to talk about the history, what it is, all those things you will have to analyze. It is not possible. We are only doing an evaluation. Right? And then the first one. Bridge analysis. The second one is better. What analysis of what? You cannot analyze all the bridges. Analysis of pre-stressed concrete bridge. Right? So the type of bridges that are going to be analyzed. So it is narrowed down. Same thing. ATIS project. Now bridge analysis or analysis of concrete bridges. That is a narrowed down topic. But look at the last topic. ATIS project. ATIS project, an investigation of ATIS on the Southern Highway. So it's specific. We are looking at the ATIS project in relation to the Southern Highway. So we are specifying, right? Now, for example, we might say students' preference for private or public sector jobs. So is it an looking at, are you going to talk about all the students' preferences? University students, school students? No. Only maybe university students and even only within your university. So you might have to write within a colon a study done on the University of Vocational Technology in Ratmalana. A study based on the students' responses of this University of Vocational Technology. So you need to specify where it is, right? If it is university students, if it is all university students, you need to collect data from all university students. But if you collect data only from your university, you need to specify it as a study based on student responses from this university or a study based on bridges in the Western province in Sri Lanka, right? So specifically you need to mention about it. Right. Okay, then we'll move on to the second component, the summary, right? The summary, sometimes referred to as the executive summary, provides a brief overview of the substance of the report, usually no more than half a page. It can change, right? So what is the summary actually about? It is not an introduction to the topic. The summary should outline all the key features of your report, including the topic, what you did, how you did, and the main outcomes of your work. Now, that is the basic aspect. Those are the basic things in a report, right? The topic, what you did, how you did, the main outcomes of the topic. And then you have the aims. These are the what you call the aims or the goals of the research, right? What are your expected outcomes? And then you write the methodology. The aims are what you did it, what you did, and how you did it. That is the methodology. And then the main outcome, that is the conclusion and recommendation, right? Findings of the study. Then we have the recommendation. So all those chapters are summarized in the abstract or the executive summary or the summary. So if the summary is not an introduction to the report, you have to clearly remember this, right? You have in the summary, you should have the whole thesis summarized. Now the whole project report should be summarized in the thesis. Clear, right? What you did, your findings, all those things have to be mentioned clearly. Right, now here are two summaries. Can you read for yourselves in 2 minutes and see which is the better summary? The first one is short, but don't think that because the first one is short, it is a bad summary, right? There are plus and negative sides of in both summaries. So look at it and tell me, read the two summaries and tell me which one is the best. Both have their shortcomings, but you can find one that is better than the other one. Okay, were you able to find out which is the better one? Right, both are summaries of the same report. The first one, the aim of this project is to design a car using fuel cell technology. So it gives the purpose of the project. The aim of the project is to design a car using fuel cell technology. This technology is investigated and an outline of two designs is given. So the technology is investigated and the outline of the two designs is given. Each design is suitable for a different market, but both are designed to the same criteria. Sketches are provided for each design. Then second one, two alternative designs for a fuel cell powered car are presented, right? So they have designed a fuel cell powered car, a car which is fueled by fuel cell, right? And two alternative designs have been presented or proposed. Car A, which uses hydrogen fuel, is a sedan designed for the executive market. It provides extra luxury for the driver. So the driver has a lot of luxuries, but a family can also use it. But spacious. Spacious means having a lot of space, right? Big, but it is spacious enough for a family use. It has good comforts for the driver and has enough space for a family use as well. Car B, powered by hydrogen and oxygen, is a medium-sized hatchback which offers a range of features for the family. So the car B is also the same, powered by hydrogen and oxygen, but it is a medium-sized one. And it offers a lot of features for the family. The earlier one was a different one. It had a lot of luxuries for the driving person, right? So it's designed for the executive market. Here it is designed for families. So the market is the maybe the middle income families, right? While both cars are efficient for short trips, they lack the range and speed desirable for long journeys. So both have the same criteria. Both cars incorporate similar safety features and fulfill the design criteria of having low exhaust emissions and using environmentally friendly materials. So using hydrogen fuel cell, that means both cars use environmentally friendly material, but they have the same safety features and low exhaust emissions. So low exhaust emissions means the carbon dioxide emissions are less, right? So there is less environmental pollution. However, car B is recommended as it has slightly lower power consumption and is more economical to manufacture, more easy, more economical, cost saving to manufacture. Right, car B is recommended. So the recommendation and the conclusion is given here. Which is the better summary? In both of them are not best, right? But what do you think is the better one? Anuradi, sorry, Anuttara, what is the better summary here?
I think second one.
Second one, yes. Why do you think it is the better one?
It has fully output of about report.
Yes, all the full details of the report, right? The full details of the report are given, but there are some good features in the first report as well, right? You might say that it is a better summary. Now, for example, the aim of the project, right? It was not mentioned, it is not mentioned in the second report. The aim of this project is to design a car using that aim has not been given here. So this the project abstract starts very soon. Two alternative designs for a fuel cell powered car presented. So it started abruptly, right? In the previous one, the aim is given. So that is good. Then each design is suitable for a different market, but both are designed to the same criteria. It's a kind of a summary. And it is good, right? So in the second one, we have a comparison of both cars, but we do not get the different market, and the summary of it is not there, right? So there are a lot of details, but one is a better summarization. But if you ask what is the good summary, number two is the better one, because it gives all the details, right? What is the recommendation, what is the conclusion, all that is given in the second one. Right. Did you understand the content of this, each one of you? If you did not understand, at least in the chat box, let me know, right? Because we are discussing language as well. Right. Then we come to the table of contents. So the table of contents, the contents page or the table of contents sets out the sections and subsections of a report and their corresponding page numbers. It should clearly show the structural relationship between the sections and subsections. A reader looking for specific information should be able to locate the appropriate section easily from the table of contents. Right, so there should be a clear connection between the heading and the page number. For example, you cannot give one page number in your table of contents but have a different page number in the report itself, right? And the other one is, there should, once you look at the table of contents, you should be able to understand the structure of the report. We'll look at this. So the title of the section, that could be technology, right? So bridge building technology, right? So under that first subheading, right? In the maybe talking about one technology, second subheading, right? Another technology. Then second title, main section would be application of bridge building to the specific project, right? So what technologies have been investigated? So maybe you talk about one bridge here, the second one here, right? So there should be a clear structural unity when you look at the table of contents, you should be able to identify how each topic is related to the whole chapter and to the whole thesis, right? So that is what is said. They should clearly show the structural relationship between sections and subsections. And a person who is looking for the specific information should be able to locate the appropriate section easily from the table of contents, right? So it should give you a clue as to how to identify the information that you are looking for, where to find this particular bit of piece of information. We will look at how it can be numbered. The conventions for section and page numbering are as follows, right? So see here, so the first main title, maybe say it's the introduction. So that would be 1.0. So here you do not have any contents, right? It is just the title that is there. Then under this, we have 1.1. So 1.0 would be introduction. 1.1 would be technology used for building in the 21st century. So under 1.1, you have the first chapter, part of the first chapter. Then 1.2, right? Technology used after the 20th century, something, right? So the first, all the subsections of first chapter 1 are numbered as 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, and so on. If it is more than that, you would have 1.2.1, like this, right? So take the report of a senior student and see how they have numbered it. And then next one would be 1.2.2. And so it goes, right? Second title would be, the second chapter would be 2.0, 2.1, 2.2, then 2.2.1, 2.2.2, and so on, right? So you will get used to it. Now, before you come to the table of contents, right? The table of contents and all the other chapters which come before the introduction should be lowercase Roman numerals. So the first part of it is the, you don't have to place the number 1 on the title page. Who can read this? Can someone read? Yes, Chaturanga, can you read?
Number the all. Number all the.
Preliminary.
Preliminary pages for is Roman number numeral. You don't have to place the number
one
on the title page. Just count it and put
two
on the second page of your report. Preliminary pages are any which come before the introduction, including the summary and, where applicable,
acknowledgements. Okay, go on.
Number all remain pages of your report with Arabic numerals. Thus, the report proper being on page 1 with your introduction, which is usually selection 1. Provide a title in your table of content of describe the content of each appendix.
Good. Right. So now there are two type systems of numbering pages, right? The first one is the Roman numerals. So Roman numerals lowercase Roman numerals are 1, 2, 3, 4. Like this, right? So you see this here, those are the not capitalized, simple Roman numerals, right? In simple letters. That is one system. And the other one is using the Arabic numerals, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, commonly that we find here. So when do we use the Roman numerals? For pages before the introduction. So that means the title page, table of before table of contents, summary, then acknowledgements, then table of contents. So those four or five pages that come before the proper starting of the report, before the introduction, right? So they have to be numbered using Roman numerals. So title page would be 1, right? So but we do not add this here, then abstract would be 2, acknowledgements would be 3, and so on, right? In table of contents also 4, right? Then introduction, that would be 1, using the Arabic numerals. Understood? So the proper report begins on page 1 with the introduction. Provide a title in your table of contents to describe the contents of each appendix, right? So in the appendix, also the appendices, it's better to mention what they are. Imagine you write and so on like this, and then you have appendices. Okay. So the appendices, they have to be numbered. Appendix 1, map of contents. Appendix 2, what it is, right? So it is not a good idea to leave just as appendix 1, appendix 2, and so on, right? Okay. So is it clear up to this? Did every one of you understand? Because it's important, right? This is an important lesson, so you need to have understood it. If anyone, if there's a section which you don't understand, let me know. Even in the chat box, right? Or if it is too fast, you can ask me to explain again. Right, so no problems then, no issues. Shall we move on to the second next section? Okay, right. So it means, silence means there might not be no problems. Yes, Chamali, can you read this? Yes, Chamali?
Yes, madam. Introduction. The introduction provides the background information needed for the rest of your report to be understood. The introduction. The introduction should include the background to the topic of your report to set your work in its broad context, a clear statement of the purpose of the report, usually to present the results of your research, investigation, or design, a clear statement of the aims of the project, technical background necessary to understand the report, example, theory of assumptions.
Right, theory of assumptions, correct. So we'll look at it right now. We have looked at the preliminary pages, such as the title page, table abstract or summary, and the table of contents, right? So those are important. Now we are coming to the proper report. So it's the introduction. You are making the background for your report. For example, if you have selected a particular field of study, right? Say it's about bridges. So why do you need to select bridges for this topic. What is the background? Is it underdeveloped in our country? There have people or students have not written many reports on this subject. So what is the background related to this topic? Right? How do you establish your topic in that context? Imagine no one has talked about bridges in Sri Lanka. So then your project becomes very valuable or important. Right? So the background to the topic of your report to set your word in its broad context. What does this mean? The context. Now, for example, the bridges, that context, right? The bridge building context. So where does your work fit in? Maybe people have not talked about the type of bridges that you know, right? The type of bridge that you are talking about. Maybe it is a new model or it uses a new technology. Maybe the latest technology is used. So what is special about it when it comes to this bridge building, the context? That means looking at the research that other people have done. So far, we have not used this type of bridges. So that is why my one is important. Right? So you establish the background, the ground. You prepare the ground for your argument. Then second one is the clear statement of the purpose of the report. Usually to present the results of the research, investigation or design. Right? Then you give the purpose or the aims or goals of the research study. That is important. Sometimes you might get it as a separate heading even. Then next one is a clear statement of the aims of the project. The purpose, the aim, and then next one is the technical background necessary to understand the report. If there is anything, a lot of difficult jargon, so then you will have to give a definition of what it is. So you can, now, for example, if you get a scholarship from your university to another foreign degree or something, you might need to write a report for your own university. So you need to use that particular jargon, right? What are the theories related to that, right? Present the results of the research, investigation, or clear statement of the purposes of the report, a clear statement of the aims of the project, technical background necessary to understand the report. So the theory, right, the technology that you are talking about, what theory will be used to do the analysis, all that you talk in the introduction. Then we come to the body part of the report. Yes, who can read this?
So, body of the report. This is main part of the report where you present your work. The body of the report presents the information from your research, both real world and theoretical, or your design, organizes information logically under appropriate headings, convey information in the most effective way for communication, uses figures and tables. The presentation of information should flow logically so that the reader can follow the development of your project. It is also essential that you choose concise but informative headings and subheadings so that the reader knows exactly what type of information to expect in each section.
Okay, right, the main body of the this is the main part of the report where you present from your research, both real world and theoretical, or your design, right? So the theories which you outlined in the introduction, now you can discuss them in the body, right? The theory part. So the information has to be logically organized under headings, dividing it into subsections, right? So headings and subheadings to be there. Conveys information in the most effective way for communication, uses figures and tables. So what does it mean by conveys information in the most effective way? Maybe using charts and graphs, right? What is the easiest way to communicate this information? Maybe using appendices, maybe using diagrams, right? Listen, always you don't have to write paragraphs or charts. You can, in the body of the report or even in the introduction, you can use citations, what other people have said. If it is about bridge building, what other people have said about the topic. If it is about surveying, about how young people are addicted to social media, if that is your topic, what other people have said about the topic, you could include in the body of your report or even in the introduction, right? So then you have to give the citation and refer to them in your list of references. So uses figures and tables. Presentation of information should show logically so that the reader can follow the development of the headings and subheadings, so that the reader knows exactly what type of information to expect in each section, right? So this is very important. You need to give proper titles to your sections of the report so that you know, the reader knows what to expect in each section, right? So the information cannot be misleading. You must not have one topic and then give some other information in the section. There should be a clear connection or a logical flow between what you want to write and what you write actually, right? There should be a clear sort of a connection. Okay, right? So we cannot do it is a little, you might feel a little bored, but you can't do, you have to go through this, right? We cannot do any questions or answers on this. Yes, so that is the body. Now we are looking at some conclusions and recommendations, how you have to write them down. The conclusion section provides an effective ending to your report. I did the project, this is how I did the methodology, this is what I did, and this is what I found. Now, conclusion is what you found from the research, the results. And according to the results, what are your conclusions that you draw from the results? The content should relate directly to the aims of the project as stated in the introduction and some of the essential features of your work. Now, I'm sad that I can't have a whiteboard here. Right, so what you call the aims of the study, right? Aims. And then accordingly we have the methodology, right? So that has to be clearly identified, the methodology. And then we come to the results, right? I'll just put the results, the R, and then the conclusion. And based on the conclusion, the recommendations. So, what are the aims of the research? Then, according to the aims, you decide what is the method I'm going to find this out. Am I going to... survey a group of people about the bridges, or am I going to do a field study on that, right? And according to the method, now you do the research, the results. So aims and results should be clearly connected. This is what I expected to find, and this is what I found, right? This is what I wanted to find out, and this is what I found. There should be a clear connection. You cannot have one aim and different results, right? So they can't be two different things. Then based on the results, you draw your own conclusion. Now, a lot of students make a problem here also. They say the results are one thing, but the conclusions, they write your own ideas. For example, easily you get misled. That you start, if it is about if you are doing a project report about cleanliness in the university premises, according to the results only you need to write the conclusions. You cannot write your own opinion there in that final result, right? If the students have said that we need to have separate bins for plastic, glass and paper, that should be in your conclusion or the results. You cannot also add things to that on your own, right? So that is not allowed. So conclusions based on the results, and then also recommendations based on the results. So those things need to be clearly identified. So the content should relate directly to the aims of the project and in the introduction and some of the essential features of your work. This section states whether you have achieved your aims, gives a brief summary of the key findings or information, highlights the major outcomes of the investigation and their significance, right? So a good idea that our supervisor used to say, tell us is, start the conclusion by restating the aims. For example, if you started your aim as to identify the systems used in analyzing data in multinational organizations. So your project, this aim starts with to analyze the systems. So if it is to analyze the systems, in the conclusion you say, the aim of this project was to analyze the systems used in analyzing large sets of data in multinational organizations. Accordingly, this aim has been achieved by this, right? So you state one aim, you write whether the aim was achieved or not. Similarly, you write the second aim and you write whether the aim was achieved or not. Afterwards, you can write what is the methodology you used, and based on the findings, what are your recommendations, right? Highlights the major outcomes of the investigation and their significance. So that in the conclusion and recommendation, you can give an emphasis to the significant outcomes or the major outcomes. The main outcomes of your research or of your project, you can highlight them here in the last chapter, right? So conclusions and recommendations, that is the last chapter of your report. Okay, so we look at the examples and conclusions given here. The first example is, the aim of this project is to design a mobile phone cover. Conclusion is, in this report, a design for a mobile phone cover has been presented. Did you see the aim is this? The aim was to design a mobile phone cover. So in the conclusion, they have said, in this report, a design for a mobile phone cover has been presented. So see how the aim has been achieved. In the second example, the aim of this investigation is to analyze the bus delays at the intersection of the bus route and Wellington Road at Monash University. So that is the aim. The conclusion is, in this report, bus delays were analyzed. It was found that, based on the findings, it is recommended that. Right? So can you see the conclusion is clearly related to the aim, right? They are not two different things. Right, now here is a conclusion from a report entitled Preliminary Design of a Bridge. Yes, can you read this silently, right? And tell me, I will ask you a few questions based on this text. We have only how many slides for report writing? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So 9 sides are there, right? So can you read? Yes. We'll see whether you have understood. Two designs for the bridge to be constructed on the southern highway across Mohr River have been presented. Which one is the best design for the bridge? Yes, Tamali? Which is the better design? Anuttara?
Design one.
Yes, correct. Okay, design one. Then Anuttara, next question, right? Is it correct? There are incorporated round fires on piled foundations in both bridges. Is that true? Then there are round fires on the foundation in both bridges. Is it true?
Yes, it's true.
True. Yes, next one. Is Chaturanga there in the class? Next one, even if there are, if the name is here, if there's no one is answering, I will cut the name from the attendance. Yes, Chaturanga?
Yes, madam.
Oh, yes. What are the advantages of the second design?
Made of steel and thus has longer span and fewer piers.
Good. Right. It is made of steel, has longer spans, better lifespan and fewer piers. Correct. Next one. Is there a student from the network department? Who is it? Ahmed? Why is design one the better design? Is the human there? Ratnaika, why is design one the better design?
Because this design requires minimal formwork in the construction of its concrete deck. It is relatively easy to erect and it maintains stability during transportation and construction. In addition, it is cheaper to build and more durable.
Good. So that is the reason, right? Why it is better one. It requires minimal formwork. Minimal means very little. The minimum formwork. In the construction of its concrete deck to build up the concrete deck, only very little formwork is necessary, and it is easy to erect. Erect means build, right? You erect a building, you put up a building, something like a tall building, that is called erect. A tower. Now, for example, a signal tower, we call erect a tower, right? And it maintains stability. That is here stability during transportation and construction. Even while making the bridge and even when we are transporting, there is stability. In addition, it is cheaper to build and more durable. So, those are the reasons, right? the conclusions from a report titled Preliminary Design of a Bridge, right? So two designs have been designed, and which one is the better one? So can you see the conclusion, right? Clearly related to the topic of the report. So even in your reports, this should be the design proper. There should be a clear relation between the topic, purpose of the report, methodology, results, conclusions and recommendations, right? Right, then we come to the references. This is, there are two parts when it comes to referencing. That means in-text citation, citations in the text of the report, and at the end of the report, a list of references, right? So if in the report you have the citations, like what to write, if you are taking information from the internet, you write it down. Cite means, right? So in the text, you cite the thing, and at the end of the report, you say where you got this information. That is called the list of references. Now, what is special about this? A citation shows that information comes from another source. The reference list gives the details of these sources. Did you understand clearly? You need to use in-text citations and provide details in the references section. We'll look at that, what it means. Now see, this is an in-text citation, right? Corrosion is defined as a chemical action which harms the properties of a metal. So from where has this definition been taken? Glendinning, 1973, page 12. So see how they have referred to this, the name of the author, year of publication of the book, and the page number. Because corrosion, right? You know what corrosion is, right? Corrosion reduces the life of the material, and protection procedures are expensive. Special corrosion resistant metals have been developed. What are they? Monolithics, and are particularly suited to marine applications. What does it mean by marine applications? Marine means closer to the sea. We talk about marine pollution, sea pollution, right? So marine applications, when you are talking about metals which are closest to the sea, like in hotels or whatever, so those metals get corroded easily. There is a lot of corrosion in the metals near the seaside. So for that we have proposed some corrosion resistant metals such as monolithics, right? So again, Glendinning, 1973, name of the author and year of publication. Now earlier we had the year, name of author, year of publication and page number. But in the second instance, we don't have the page number. Why is that? It is not the exact words of the author. But if you are writing the exact words of the author, you have to put them within inverted commas like this. Did you see? So the comma is there, taking the exact words of the author. So then you have to include the page number. But if you are just writing his idea, right? Special corrosion resistant metals have been developed, including monolithics, which are particularly suited to marine applications. That is Glendinning's idea, right? So you are not taking his exact words. When you are writing only his idea, you can write only the name of the author and year of publication. Okay, page number is not necessary. So this is called in-text citation. So also, this is one type of citation. There is what you call a different citation. Right, have a look at this. This is what you call indented, right? If you're taking whole chunks, Here it is, right? So copying, taking a whole paragraph, then it has to be indented like this. So there's the according to Glendon, and then indented paragraph, you go on. At the end of the paragraph, you cite, put the year of publication and page number like this. Right? So that is another way of writing in-text citation. Then what are the list of references? So here is a reference list NK. Glendinning, EH, dot 1973, and name of the book, English in Mechanical Engineering, comma, Oxford. That means where it was published, the place of publication, right? Comma, Oxford University Press, that is the publisher, right? So it would be like name of author, right? Then initials, then year of publication, name of book, usually sometimes it is italicized, right? Now here it is not italicized. Place of publication and publisher. So publisher could be in your context like Vijayapa or Sarasavi, whatever. If it is a foreign book, you know where to find the publisher, right? On the left hand side of the page with the copyright, you have Penguin or Oxford University Press or Amazon or whatever, right? The publisher is mentioned. So you have to find the publisher and mention it there. So the, now you should know there is what you call two, there are referencing systems such as APA or Harvard, like that. So you have to ask the head of the department what is the reference method for your department. If he says APA, go by APA. If it is Harvard method, you go by the Harvard method. APA is the American Psychological Association. They have their own method of putting references. Harvard is the University of Harvard. They also developed the referencing system. That is their method. So if it is the referencing Harvard method, you take all the examples from that, right? So maybe for in some instances, for example, the name of the book is italicized. Sometimes it is not. Then sometimes after this 1973, there is a comma or a dot. Right? So it differs from school to school. Did you understand? If you just type APA method or Harvard method of referencing, you will get, and there are guidelines, so accordingly you have to put the reference list, right? So after the reference list in case you have the appendices. So this is the last bit of our lesson today, right? Appendices, how to number them, and then we have the activity. Yes. Read the appendices section to yourself quietly. Right. So appendices, they contain the material that is too detailed to include in the main report. For example, if it is something like a map, you don't need to put the entire map on the report. So then that will go into the appendices or the results of a full lab report or the full analysis report. So full reports which are too long to put in the middle of a thesis or middle of a research report, they can go in at the end and they are called appendices, right? They say each appendix must be given a number or a letter and a title. So for example, appendix 1 dash map or something like that. Or appendix A, so on, right? Each appendix must be referred to by number or letter at the relevant point in the text. So for example, now see, in the middle of the report, they say the data obtained are summarized below. The detailed data are given in Appendix 3. If you see, you cannot just mention the detailed data is given in the appendices. That is not allowed, right? You have to specifically mention which appendix it is. Okay. Right, so I can remember doing this lesson, I think, but I can't remember whether I did it for you or for the previous batch. But report writing is a little difficult or a different lesson. I mean, it's something new for you. Right? So what are the sections of this that you did not understand here? Even in the chat box, now you have something like 15 minutes time extra. You can say what are the sections in the report that you did not understand, the sections in the lesson. Where is Yashini here today? I thought she had posted a comment in the WhatsApp group. There are very few students here, only even the students who come on other days also not here. Right, ask all of them to come, otherwise I'm not going to correct the answers. Any sections that you did not understand, or is it too fast or whatever? So we go to back to the title page and see whether you have understood all the aspects. So we know the title page, it has to be narrowed down, right? Cannot be too vague. It is not bridge analysis, analysis of this type of bridges. Or a case study, types of careers, a study based on the student responses of University of Professional Technology. So the topic has to be narrowed down, right? Then we know the summary or the abstract, that is the a summary of the all the chapters, including the title, objectives, method, findings, conclusion and recommendations. The summary of all these chapters should be included in the summary, right? Then acknowledgements will be there if you need it. Then table of contents and introduction, right? So you know, for the first part, you don't number the title page, right? It is not numbered, but for summary, you put number 2 in Roman numerals. So all these pages which come before the introduction are put in lowercase Roman numerals. Starting from the introduction, you use page 1, 2, and so on, right? Then introduction, when you're writing the introduction, you state the background to the research. You have to say why your research is important and so on. And what are the theories that are related to your study. So preparing the background for the research is the introduction. Then middle sections with numbered headings, that means the body of the report, right? So there you should mention 1.1, 1.1.1, 1.1.2, and so on. You go under headings and subheadings, you discuss the middle section, the body of the report. Then conclusion and recommendations, what is important thing, it has to be related to the title and the objectives. So it's a good way to start the conclusion by stating the objective, right? The objective of this study was to present 2 designs of bridges. So this has been presented like this. So you do that here, right? This to find a what is the best design for a bridge, and accordingly the best design is this. So you give your conclusion, and references. So you have to decide whether it is APA or Harvard or whatever. And then in-text citations, if it is there are in-text citations, they should be referred to at the end, right? And then appendices, they have to be numbered. Appendix A, Appendix B, and so on, and the title has to be provided. Appendix A, data of the full analysis, or information of the full analysis. Something like that has to be given in the appendices. Right? So is that clear? Once you, if I can find, I will forward the, at least a research proposal or a sample research report to you, so that you can get an idea of what it looks like, right? Yes, so here it is about citation. A citation shows the information that comes from another source. You incorporate you have to use references when you incorporate information from other sources, factual material, graphs and tables of data, pictures and diagrams. Even for these things, if you are taking data from say an annual report or a financial statement or something, they have to be referred, right? They have to be included in the references list. You quote, if you are quoting word for word from another work, then when you do this, the page number must be given in the in-text citation. So see here, it is very important. Use the prescribed method for referencing, IEEE or Harvard, etc. So an example of in-text citation and reference list entry using the Harvard reference style is given below, right? So this is the Harvard style, this one, right? Now this is not applicable. These two are Harvard reference citation and reference methods, right? Others are different. Anything else? Yes, I will send the presentation to the group. But apart from that, did you understand clearly everything about the lesson, right? So do not say that you have not understood anything, right? And another, so we'll finish the lesson from here now. Another thing I want to tell you is that for the speaking assignment, now we can't do the group presentations now. So I will be using something like interviews or something like a Viva or something like interviews to test your speaking ability, right? And I will be giving you marks. I will be giving, let you know the details when and where of how to do this, but do some speaking practice at home, right? Or with your friends, try to speak in English and update your English speaking skills. On a particular topic, I will give it to you. Right? Okay. Any questions? Shall we finish the lesson? No questions. Okay, right, so then we'll finish it off. Thank you for coming for the lecture. Please inform all the students to come attend the lectures, right? So next lesson will be tomorrow at 8:30.